poor riggers, ignoring best practices, creating a horror show on the job site, each lift oozing with danger, desperate to finish the job, to go home to their happy life. We don't need to inspect our gear, they said. So, it stayed in service, still dangling overhead. Real terrors and horrors. Bent and twisted, nicks, cuts, gouges. A real freak show attached to a crane hook. That's what happens, kiddos. And we are going to show it all to you on this Scary Rigging Spooktacular.
Welcome to the Rigging Horror Show, where the curse chains swing and the cold winds blow. If you skip your checks, the danger grows. Inspect your gear or down we go.
Welcome to the Rigging Horror Show. Step up and witness the horrors pulled straight from the field. But what is a horror show without a fearless spectator? To judge this freak show of failed rigging, we need an expert. Joining us tonight, a man who came here to talk inspections and wound up in a rigging nightmare. Corporate Rigging Inspection Manager, Tom Horner. Our opening act, found dangling high above an unsuspecting crew, a twisted talon of terror. Behold the hooks of horror. Tell us, Tom, what does your trained but utterly unimpressed gaze reveal in these abominations?
I see a lot of damage. I see a lot of scariness. I see a lot of lessons to be learned. This hook right here, obviously been side-loaded against a load, hence the twisting of the hook, twisting of the eye. We can also see the broken mechanism, as this would have been a latch lock type hook, locking mechanism.
What if this were to stay in service?
Definitely a violation, definitely a danger, something that you'd want to address at the training level. Why did it stay in service? These are interesting, obviously in a hot metal situation where the hook was actually dipped in the hot metal. What was the heat? And how did that heat affect the strength of the hook? On this hook, the material, the hot metal, filled up the hook itself, so there's lack of mobility in the chain attached to the hook itself and then the movement of the chain itself. This is a great example of a grab hook that was probably tip-loaded, hence the reason the opening and the twist. But I would say also based on the wear here, what was the application that caused this to happen? So I would go back to, yes, this hook is obviously bad, but there's probably a training and an application use concern with that hook right there. We have another old hook. It's probably been in service for many, many years. If you can see here, the wear in the eye, the chain itself would have been doing this. So probably in a heavy swinging application under a lot of load for a long period of time. And it should have been caught much earlier from the daily inspections by the operators.
Quite a bit more than 10%, would you say?
Absolutely.
And definitely if this were to stay in service?
Definitely gonna be a failure at some point. Obviously, we're more than 10% wear. But when you create this kind of wear, there's gonna be slight cracks in the hook that are probably forming, which become what we call a stress riser. The link here itself may have also worn, but maybe that failed. And there was an actual hook leaving the assembly itself.
Now, if you thought the hooks of horror were truly twisted, just wait until you see what's been dangling in the dark corners of the job site next. For what is a hook without the chain that binds? Oh, dear audience, what cursed chains they are! Tell us, Tom, what does your unbreakable inspector's stare reveal in these links of lunacy?
This is a terrifying grouping of alloy chains. What we can see is a completely homemade assembly. Somebody took a piece of bar, made their own master link, attached some pieces of chain that they found lying around, created their own J-hooks, but definitely not compliant, definitely needed to be pulled from service. A great example, here's a normal piece of alloy chain. But as you can see, as you go down through the rest of the alloy chain itself, it was used in some sort of a process where it was dipped, and you can actually see as you go through the chain, the amount of material that is being worn away from the chain itself. You can see the difference. Definitely should have been removed from service much, much earlier. It might have even been part of a failure. We're only seeing the chain itself. More homemade items. The plate hooks themselves, somebody took a piece of plate, did the bending themselves, burn out their hole, attached their chain with some what would be considered illegal attachments. And as you can see, this was probably their master link that was over some other type of a hook. Absolutely a great example of a non-compliant item and definitely needed to be replaced. We have a hot metal situation. This either fell into the hot metal itself or something spilled over onto it. Obviously unusable at this point, but even a small amount of hot metal touching an alloy chain like this could indicate that the chain was heated past its acceptable temperatures, resulting in some sort of a loss of working load. Looking at this chain right here, this is another great example. Very old CO, properly made, properly tagged. I can see the information on the alloy chain sling, so that's a good part. But what's very interesting is when you look at the chain, you have your 7/32 alloy, but then again, it was dipped into some sort of a situation that has removed. But even the hammer lock itself, the coupling link up here has been worn. So again, it's not just gonna be that this chain might fail and break. Where are all the pieces gonna go when they blow apart? Who are the people who are in the area in the line of fire? What happens to your product you were lifting? Did you hurt the hoist that this was hanging off of due to the shock load of the breakage? The scary part here is that something like this was in service and definitely should have never been there or been there this long.
Yes, Tom. Chains may rattle the soul, but what of the link that ties them all together? Step right up, my frightful friends, and shudder at the mangled master links!
This one here is really interesting to talk about. This is an oversized master link with handles welded to the master link to hands-free operation. These are professionally done. We had a complete failure of the master link. Now, one might argue, did the application of the handle cause some sort of a defect for that breakage to have taken right at the place of the weld? Over here, we have a large pair master link made by a professional manufacturer, as stated here. And then we see a failure point where broke apart.
This could have been a very dangerous failure.
Absolutely. There's a reason it happened, not just wear and tear. Something definitely was used improperly here. And then lastly, looking at this large Crosby link, definitely a lot of wear. It never should have gotten to these points during the daily inspections. And wear with the mushrooming, if they do start creating stress risers, little cracks, you would begin creating failure points, potentially, at that point of the master link itself.
Yes, Tom. But what of the slings that bear the load? Wire rope, twisted and woven, swaged and spliced, but kinked and bent and wicked cores exposed. Feast your eyes on the sinister slings!
This is what you will typically see in a lot of wire ropes. They're used how somebody needs to use them to get a job done, so they're often abused. This sling, immediate failure, no tag. But as I'm looking through it, I'm already feeling all of the broken wires, obviously kinked. Now, Custer should have known to take this and throw this just in the trash, pull a new one out. One right here, we have one. It's nice to see a tag on it. Already felt a broken wire. That is one thing to be very cognizant of when you're looking at wire slings. It will prick your fingers immediately. They could be very dirty depending on where you're using them, but you just don't want to tear up your hands.
Everybody loves a tetanus shot.
Oh, I'm not sure about that, but yes. We'll just use the term that these are kinks. Kinks will not come out under load. If under load, your deformation does not come out. Definitely something we want to consider in the passing or failure of an item. But also look in here, you can see over a small D to D ratio. So yes, this would be another removal from service. Not something atypical out there in the world. This larger one here is interesting. Because however they used it, created a tremendous amount of crushed and broken wires. Don't have to take much time to really look at that. Within this conversation with the customer, we just want to say, hey, you know, we shouldn't be finding this. You should be pulling this out of service much, much sooner.
And so, my wretched, risky riggers, we come to the final curtain. You thought you had seen every horror, twisted hooks, cursed chains, mangled master links. But from the deepest pits of neglect, we unveil the most condemned connections of them all. One last scare, if you dare. Behold, a freak show of failed rigging, hellish hardware, the red-tagged rigging rejects. What does your grave inspector's stare reveal in this cabinet of catastrophic connections?
That's definitely what we have here, are some rigging rejects. A bolt, a nut, welded together. We see variations of this in many ways all the time. Here we have a great example of a custom-made shackle. There's manufacturer's information on here. But what really is driving this home is the wear here in the eye. Obviously, well past 10%. Why wasn't it inspected? Why wasn't it caught? Why was it allowed? Sometimes your fittings are sitting in here and they mask this type of wear. So if you don't move things around, you might not catch this type of thing. Some hoist strings right here. Breakage of the top clip.
Removal criteria?
Absolutely. What you'll also see sometimes with hoist strings is people will remove the factory bolt system and put in their own for a different type of application. Definitely a no-no. Here we have a shackle. It has information on it, but we also see that it's made in China. China is not a manufacturer. It's just where it was made. So basically, just on the lack of manufacturer's information, it's gotta go. A properly US made shackle, it's got all the requiring identification marks, but this would be something we can see where the threads are extending past incorrect bolt. So what happened to the original bolt and why did somebody replace it with that one?
Again, removal criteria?
Absolutely. We're not going to take a chance.
And so, Tom, what last warning will you leave for the riggers before cursed gear like this haunts their job site?
When anybody is doing your periodic inspection, we shouldn't find a lot of stuff like this. With all of this, a lot of this could have been eliminated with a lot of proper training, a lot of proper application of the frequent inspections, and definitely staying compliant with the periodic inspection requirements. So what we saw today, we're glad we caught them. We're glad somebody caught them, but we want to make sure that we don't get complacent and think that it's okay and that these things are regularly found in the field.
You see, my sinister slingers, the monsters we've shown you tonight aren't lurking under your bed. They're dangling above your head. But they're not fairy tales. They're real, pulled from the field.
and ignored long enough to become true Jobsite Nightmares. Because the real terror is skipping your inspections. It's on the shrug, the good enough, the gear left in the box, one lift too long. And that's where the horror lives. So protect your crew, inspect your rigging, or your next job may star in the next rigging horror. And if you want to keep your gear out of my freak show, call Mozilla, schedule your rigging inspection today. Because in real life, safety should never be scary. My name is Ben. Stay safe out there.